So a very, very warm welcome to Asch Wednesday 2021. Welcome back if you are rejoining us and have been to one of the last two Asch Wednesdays that we had in New York, and particular welcome if you're joining for the first time. In the words of the Forwards newspaper, James Joyce has Bloomsday, Robert Burns has Burns Night, and Sholem Asch has Asch Wednesday. Or I guess it should really be Asch Wednesday, because that would have been how his surname was pronounced in Poland. Anyway, so the idea to turn Asch Wednesday into Asch Wednesday was really the brainchild of a fabulous guy called Eitan Kensky, who became my colleague at the Book Center 3 years ago. It was a huge pleasure to work with him. And Eitan, turns out, had this idea since 2013 that Asch Wednesday should be Sholem Asch Wednesday. And so we made it happen 2 years ago, and this is year three. And obviously, it's wonderful to have people who couldn't be there at the first two joining for this one. So it's really an international event, as you'll see. And I'm really grateful to the Congress for Jewish Culture and Shane Baker, its executive director, for offering to host it and providing the tech platform for us this year and a lot of the organizational infrastructure. So please support the Congress for Jewish Culture. We'll hear more about it as we go through. They do wonderful work in the field of Yiddish. We'll run for about 90 minutes. And I really want to say a huge thank you to all the actors and creative artists who've really given tremendous amounts of time and imagination to create this program. So as Shane said earlier, share it on Facebook, like it, have a watch party. And if you want to get pen and paper or have your phone ready, there will be some questions as we go through. All right, so let's get underway. And I'm really delighted to welcome my two co-hosts for this year's event. I think it's fair to say it's not been an easy time for them. They're stuck at home in the kitchen. They're stressing about the sort of problems we've all been facing, really. How do you plan for the future? What to do about kids and their future? What are the neighbors saying about us behind our back? But in their case, a particular problem, which is this: is it time to close down the family business, the family brothel, and start a new business?
A kleinigkeit sag ich dir. Und was meinst du? Wollten sie nicht gekommen zu dir? Macht jeden Tag ein Simche, wirst du sie jeden Tag haben. In Adlerhäuser weiß man doch, wie sie halten sich. Du darfst Ernst haben für Menschen. Nicht so wie die. Bald Pan brat werden. Was ist das für ein Ballabos, sag ich, ne?
Ballabatem willst du, sollen kommen zu dir? Du hast abunnen vergessen, wer du bist.
Wer du bist? Was? Die hat schon die Gange? Die hat ein Geschäft. Jeder eine hat sich sein Geschäft. Die nimmt doch keinem nicht. Die muss handeln, was sie will, dass die allein tiefst noch nicht kein Schlags. Prüben sie noch Geld zu geben. Wirst du sehen, wie viel sie wollen nehmen von dir?
Nehmen wollen sie bei dir. Aber die ist bei sie wieder hinter euch sein. In was Mädrisch bei der Tür steht. Keimel dir keine Lehen nicht geben.
Was die meinst, Tage, sie sind ein besser für dir. Als die darfst noch nicht sehr lassen. Heint ist es eine Welt. Kommt er rein zu dir, als ein ordentlicher Jid, wie Rebelli, ein Hasset, und nimmt von dir ein schönes Dove. Und er fragt sich nicht, von wann die hast Gan, wie Gasel, aber die hast auch Stor.
Die kriegt nicht sie heuch, Sure. Die hörst, nicht sie heuch. Und nicht, was die mit einmal dem Karg brechen. Ha? Und stipp doch nicht. Stipp doch nicht, sag ich dir. Du hast das Stieb lieg. Du hast Bräut, es. Noch krieg nicht dort, wie man bett doch nicht. Jeder Hint muss kennen sein Norre. Es tut mir schon bang, die ganze Masse. Ich hab Meure. Als du wird kommen, die Mabule.
Mann, es wäre schön. Schämen sollst du dich. been in a cave. And can me sagen, was es gewesen ist nicht da. A weggeflogen. Es ist nicht da, vor wem zu schämen. Die ganze Welt ist nicht besser. Mit den Augen in der Erde wird man bedarf darum gehen.
Und wieder. Das die haben Geld. Packst die ein, das Krümmel und kein Hund kriegt nicht. Wer darf zu wissen, wie du bist gewesen?
Du es wohl schon zum Besten gewesen. Ein Stall fährt sich einkäufen. Wir in kein Ausland, wie Eisekel Fuhrmann, wären ein Mensch. Nicht mehr soll dir in die Augen kicken, wie ein Ganef.
Es schaut aber das Geschäft. In Pferd kann man nicht so koscheren Groschen verdienen. Da sieht man doch Gottsch der Möbel auf der Hand.
Du siehst schon wahr.
Und siehst du, haben wir eine Tochter. Gott sei Dank in der Leitische. Und wie alle balabadische Kinder in der Stadt, wird Gas noch oben. Nehmen einen ordentlichen Mensch für einen Mann, haben ordentliche Kinder. Was ist der mehr?
Ja. Yeah. Als die es dir führen sein, Geh los, räuft sie in ihr Manken von hinten. Halt sie dir, du in Stieb.
Gib noch einen Kick, wie viel es bräuter ihm. Ich habe einen Mullmanken aufgenommen, als sie soll Rüfklein auslernen auf Kante helfen. Sie ist doch ein Mädel. Man hat euch auch wie brave Klären. Die lass sie doch nicht auf der Gas reiß. Sie hat denn mit wem sich zu haben? Ist nicht die nicht?
Nein. Ihr will nicht, die Herrst. Ich will nicht, als mein Stieb soll sich mischen mit hinten. Upgescheit soll mein Stieb sein. Wie Kusche von Treffs upgescheit. Hinten ist ein Hasel. Und du, wohnt ein Kusche Kalle-Meidl. Ein Kusche Kalle-Meidl wohnt du. Upgescheit soll es sein.
Ist nicht, nur schrei nicht. Oh, schau! Oh, Rebelli geht!
Oh.
Wonderful. Thank you to Shane Baker and to Caraid O'Brien. And there you both are. Thank you so much for that. That was, of course, a scene from Asch's breakthrough 1906 play, God of Vengeance. And we'll see some more from it as we go through. But was that lockdown theater? Was that your kitchen theater there, lockdown theater?
No, we made that shortly after we finished a double run of God of Vengeance in Yiddish. And, you know, I just love performing with Shane so much for many reasons, but not least because we had the same incredible acting teacher, Lupa Cadison. So it feels very much of bringing her into the theatrical magic. And, you know, it was just something we did for a lark.
It's beautiful. And you know, you two have done, first of all, you've given me so many opportunities to see God of Vengeance in both Yiddish and English, and you've both been, you know, performing and identified with Asch for so many years. I really want to thank you for that work that you've done, as well as for coming in to co-host today.
Oh, well, it's been a pleasure, all of it. Total joy.
All right, so much more from both of you as we go through. But for those of you who really don't know much about Sholem Asch, we thought it would be fun to just give you a sense of his career and his lifestyle, really, because he was this extraordinary celebrity, unusually in the Yiddish literary world. And he moved from Poland to France and then to America for 10 years and then back to France and then back to America in 1939, finally to England and then to Israel. So thanks to my daughter, Clara Kanter, who put this picture reel together, Sholem Asch's Life in Pictures.
Thank you. Sexepil, to wasza broń kobieta. Sexepil, to coś co nas podnieca. Pięk, styl, szarm, szyk, tym nas zdobywacie w mig. O, jeden znak, a już nie wiemy sami, co i jak, wzdychamy godzinami. Ech, uch, och, ach, słychać coś po całych dniach. Jeden uśmiech albo jedna minka, już każdy z nas. Choćby najtwardszy głaz, od razu grzeczny jest, serdeczny jest dla każdej z was. Słaba płeć, jednak jest silniejsza, słaba płeć, a jednak najmocniejsza. Wdzięk, szyk, szarm, styl, wasza broń to seksepil.
Thank you to Clara for that, and it just occurs to me actually that it's my grandmother Ruth, who you saw there in a couple of pictures. It would be her 111th birthday today. February 17th was her birthday.
Oh my god.
So Caraid and Shane, any favorite pictures from that?
I like the 1911 painting and also the 1920 drawing quite well, and Coney Island. The whole family at Coney Island.
I love the picture of him with the tree. You know, I love all the nature imagery in his work. And I remember once reading this article when he was doing the play Our Faith in New York in 1916. He said that Americans don't have enough leisure time, and that we think of him as such a prolific writer, but he made it clear in his autobiography and some of his interviews that he spent a lot of time just being in nature, sometimes walking for 8 or 9 hours in the Polish woods a day. And I feel that in his writing, and you know, I do a lot of walks myself, so it's very meaningful to me. And he also, you can tell in those photographs that he knew how to relax, right? You know, he was in the beach and with the cigar, and I really appreciate that as a man of appetites, he could also just sit back and watch it all unfold.
Yeah, that's all very true. He was a great walker and a great lover of nature, certainly. All right, so pen and paper at the ready, quiz question number one. In that montage, Asch was in Red Square with Maxim Gorky, the Russian writer, in 1928. They'd been friends for about 20 years. So quiz question number one is, what language or languages would they have used together? And like all the questions, you have three choices. So choice one is Asch would have spoken Yiddish and Gorky would have spoken German. Answer two is that both would have spoken French. And answer three is that both could have spoken Russian, would have spoken Russian. Okay, so we'll leave those hanging and we'll answer them at the end. All right, so Yiddish and German, or both French, or both Russian. All right, so now let's go to Bat Yam, Israel. And this was Sholem Asch's last residence, 1956 and seven. He built a house there, didn't live there for very long, but the house remained a museum after he and my great-grandmother died in 1963. And it's under the curatorship of the municipality of Bat Yam, who have a museum department, Museums of Bat Yam. And they recently did a wonderful job of renovating the house, rehanging, completely redoing it. And it's been done so beautifully. As and when you have a chance, do try and visit. So thanks to curator Leonie Schein and Yaakov Herskovitz, who some of you will know, literary scholar, they have made a lovely film that shows us inside the house. So let's take a look at that.
Thank you, David, for the invitation to be part of this evening. What a wonderful event this Asch Wednesday has become. And I'm standing here in front of the Bat Yam home of the Asches. Shalom and Matilda Asch lived here from 1955 to 1957 and really made a small gem of a sanctuary for themselves here on the shores of the Mediterranean. How did they get to Bat Yam? Almost by chance. They came here after an invitation from the mayor of the small town at the time, Ben Ari, who really envisioned Bat Yam to be an artist colony. And Asch gladly chose to come here and spend his what turned out to be his last years here in Bat Yam. You'll see inside in a second, the couple curated a beautiful, small sanctuary of a home with gems from all over the world, all their travels. And this last home, though short-lived, was really something, created something very special. Let's go inside. So this is the living room of the house. As any of you who know about the Asches, the living room was very central to all of their homes, and Bat Yam was no different. They hosted here friends, colleagues, writers, and really made this a central part of this small house. The fireplace here, the beautiful collection of menorahs. Asch was a huge collector of Judaica, as well known. And this bust of Asch, a beautiful sculpture by Jacob Epstein. But I'm standing in front of one of the gems of the collection here in Bat Yam, this painting by Moritzi Gottlieb, the artist who died quite young but had a similar trajectory to Asch as far as his art and life was concerned. Born in Poland like Asch, he too was immersed in his art in Judaism at the beginning, but then drifted and took up a fascination with Christianity and Christian themes in his art. And as you can see, this beautiful painting of a shut-eyed woman has this elaborate frame that in the process of restoration posed a dilemma for the staff here at the museums of Bat Yam. Should they fill the small holes in the frame that were caused by woodworms or leave them open? They chose to leave them open to really commemorate and pay homage to the tribulations and the time that passed that this painting went through. Once upon a time, the Asch's bedroom, this is now the house archive. It holds manuscripts of unfinished work, letters that Asch received and sent, and other archival materials such as passports. Also, it has this beautiful portrait of Asch, a portrait that Marc Chagall drew in 1926 for the New Year's gift to Asch in 1927. And it has a dedication. Like many other pieces of art, books, photos in this house, Asch's tight-knit community of friends and colleagues left him many, many, many souvenirs. And this one from Marc Chagall reads, "Zum neuen gesunden Jahr, to new and healthy good year, 1927. Welcome to the heart of the house, to Shalom Asch's study, where his desk was his sanctuary and really the place where he used to write for hours, for days. Like the rest of the house, the study too has beautiful work of art, but also a library with dedications and books and photos that his friends left him. As far as art's concerned, these two beautiful Chagalls show two very different sketches, both very beautiful in their own way. One, again, for the new year, for 1926, Chagall depicts the custom of Kapore, and he dedicates it to Asch for the new year. And next to it, you can see a Chagall that is on the stationery of the house in Stamford, Connecticut. And I can imagine Chagall just sitting there after a beautiful vacation at the Asch's house and they were wonderful hosts, and just sketching out this half horse, half human figure just off the cuff. Right next to us is Asch's desk and the wonderful, comfortable chair that I was lucky enough to ride in for several months. But I'd like to end here with the library. This small, beautifully curated library has some absolute gems in it, be it Bialik dedicating his collected works to Asch, writing to Asch with beautiful friendship to my good friend Sholem Asch, with much love, Chaim Nachman Bialik, Be'ahava Rabba Chaim Nachman Bialik, or this novel by Agnon, with an elaborate, long dedication like only Agnon can, and I won't tire you with it, but really another beautiful, beautiful book that Asch received from a friend. But also photos like this photo of Asch and Bialik in Bad Gastein, Austria, strolling on the promenade in a vacation they took there together, Be'ahava Chaim Nachman Bialik. This is a really a nice memento. But the dedication that I find most moving and that I'd like to end with is this small book, Hebrew translation of Kiddush Hashem, Asch's work. And Magda Baratz, now over 90, brought this book to the library here in 2018. She was the housekeeper of the Asch's in between 55 and 57. And when the house was reopening, when it was being restored, she stopped by and gave them this book. And I actually spoke to her on the opening night of the museum, and she told me how in 57, when they were leaving for London for the last time, she felt it was a final farewell, and it was a strong embrace there that when they said goodbye. And just I'll finish with this beautiful dedication. Shmi Magda Baratz, my name is Magda Baratz. I worked for Sholem Asch, and I dedicate this book to the museum, 2018.
Wow, that was incredibly moving. I'd never seen that before. I'd never been into the house. And it's so, I just was talking yesterday with a good friend of mine, the poet Anatel Hami, who's doing a piece on Moritzi Gottlieb. And we were talking about the connection between him and Asch. I knew that he had died before, but that his brother had painted him. And just to think, just all of the history and all the connections and all of the artists, both visual and literary, talking to each other, encapsulated in that house was just gorgeous.
Yeah, and I have to say they've done a really wonderful job with the house there, because I think it's only 2 or 3 years ago, David, that you sent me pictures of how it was opgelos and vernachlässigt, like it had been allowed to fall apart, and they've got a museum now.
Yeah, they've done a fabulous job. They had to repair the roof, and they took the opportunity to really remodel very sensitively the inside and highlight some of those things in the collection. Yeah.
I'm just going to take a second to say right now, thank you to all the people who are watching. If you want to like the video or share it, maybe some friends of yours would be interested in it too. We have a lot of great, interesting material coming together. We couldn't do it live this year as we like to do, as David and his family have done for the past few years. But the bonus of that is that we're going to see some very special cuts from theaters around the world. Hmm. And we'll see a little bit more of the house there too, sooner or later. David, shall we move on to the next item on the agenda? All right. So, coming up now, we have Paula Vogel, the Pulitzer Award-winning playwright and author of the play that garnered a number of Tony nominations and won a couple Tony Awards, Indecent, which is based on, as much as it's based on Sholem Asch's best-known work, God of Vengeance, it's really based on his life as well. And it's kind of a love letter to him, to the play. I wouldn't say a love letter to that time, because there were a lot of difficult times in his life, but that play, if you got to see it, it brings the rain scene from God of Vengeance to perhaps its fullest and most beautiful incarnation ever. I mean, the rain falls on the stage, the tears fall from the audience's eyes when that happens in this play. So I think she's going to talk about what first brought her to Sholem Asch and to his work. So let's hear from Paula Vogel.
Hello, my name is Paula Vogel, and I am so honored to join in the good wishes for Asch Wednesday. I'm a fortunate writer to have encountered the play God of Vengeance when I was 22 years old. One of the motifs in my play Indecent, based on the God of Vengeance, is expressed by characters in my play who are overcome with emotion. I can't breathe, one character says. Or, what is it about your work that takes my breath away? And that's because when I first read Sholem Asch, I was standing in the stacks of the Cornell Library. And as I read the play, I couldn't put it down. I couldn't sit. I read it standing up. And when I read the second act, I remembered that I felt as if I had stopped breathing. The stillness in my body was a testament to the love scene that this young writer, Sholem Asch, gave to us on the page. And although I read many of Sholem Asch's novels in preparation to write my play Indecent, for me, Asch's early play remains the formative work, informing my sense of what theater can do. Sholem Asch's deep empathy for women is joined in his work with his deep condemnation of violence against women. And for me to encounter a work written so early in the 20th century that presents the love of two women without apologies was to dare me to write with courage, with truth, and to put the fear of audience and critical response aside as I sit at my computer. So I want to express how grateful I am to all of you for keeping attention on his work and his legacy to us. And I appreciate that you do so. I appreciate all that you do. And I thank you.
Wow, that was lovely. I know that feeling so well of reading something that Asch wrote and just being stopped in your tracks. And of wondering, you know, am I reading what I'm reading? What's happening here? And they were so great to us when we were doing the Yiddish God of Vengeance at St. Clement's down the road from where they were doing Indecent on Broadway. And they sent us, you know, lots of gifts and they invited us to the show and they were very, very lovely to us. But I'm excited to delve more into God of Vengeance now, if everyone's ready to move on to the next one. Is that the Cameri Theater in Tel Aviv had a sold out run of a Hebrew version of God of Vengeance in 2018. And the scene we're about to see now takes place at the end of the third act. What happens in the second act, the end of the second act, is that Manka the prostitute works with Hindel, the head prostitute, to kidnap Rivkele. And, you know, maybe Rivkele goes willingly, maybe she doesn't, that's open to interpretation, but they start to start their own brothel. And when the parents wake up and find their daughter gone, the father, Yankel, has a nervous breakdown, but of course the mother is determined to make the good match happen. They spend all this money on a Torah scroll and she runs to the other side of town and bribes Shlomo, the pimp, the rival pimp, to bring Rivkele back to her parents. So this scene that we're about to see now takes place at the moment that Rivkele is coming home to face her parents and her father wants to know if she's still a pure girl.
אני יכולה גם לעמוד.
תן לה ללכת להתכונן, אנשים צריכים להגיע כל רגע.
היא לא הולכת לשום מקום, שבי! רבקלה, את... אני... רבקלה,
את הבת שלי. אני אבא שלך. זאת אמא שלך סורה. זה ספר התורה. תגידי לי, בת שלי, תגידי לי. את תתביישי, את לא אשמה, את האמא שלי ושל אמא שלך. תגידי לי.
תגידי,
תגידי.
מה, אתה
מנהל
את הדיונים עכשיו,
תלת ממני, לא ישנה בריאה.
תסתמי
את הפן! לא עופים מפה. אתה משוגע! לא תהיה להתקרב. טוב. נפתלה. אם הייתי חונק אותך כשהייתי על זה, היה יותר טוב בשבילך ויותר טוב בשבילי. אבל אני לא אחנוק אותך. אני שמרתי עלייך. ספר התורה. דברי.
מה אתה רוצה שאני אגיד?
את האמת, את כל האמת.
איזה אמת, אבא? איזה אמת אתה רואה פה?
את בת ישראל כשרה?
לא יודעת מה זה אומר.
לא יודעת, אז מי יודע?
ינקל, תעזוב את הילדה.
תסתכלי לי בעיניים. את עדיין הילדה שהיית? את האמת. היית עם גבר, כן או לא?
מה זה משנה? עכשיו אני בדיוק כמו הבנות האחרות, אלה שעובדות אצלך.
לא, ילדה שלי, לא, 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 לא.
תרביץ לי. לא תרביץ לי. למה אתה לא מרביץ לי? עכשיו אני בדיוק כמוך. עכשיו אני באמת הבת שלך.
בואו, בבקשה, התנסו במשפחה וצפה ברוב שרוע, גדולות ונצורות. כן. נא להכיר, אבי המשפחה, ינקל שפשוביץ, איש בעל זכויות רבות בקהילה. זכויות רבות מאוד. רעייתו, הצדקת, סורה, ואבן החושן של הבית, אלוהים. רבקלה.
שולם עלייך, רבי ינקל. שמעתי עליכם רק דברים טובים. למרות שניטל ממני מאור עיניי, אני מסונבר מאורו של הבית. אני מבטיח לך ששרק החץ כאילו צפיחית בדבש. תרשה לי ללחוץ את ידך.
נו, תרשה לו, ינקל. למה אתה לא מרשה? ינקל. כפי שרואות עיניך, אתה רואה? איזו התבטלות, איזו ענווה בפני השם, הרגליים כאילו אומרות מי אני, מי אני לאדוני. קום כבר, ינקל, לא תגיד שלום לאורחים.
ינקל!
טוב, סורה, נגיש משהו לאורחים לשתות?
בוקר טוב, רוצים לשתות משהו?
איזו אווירת חג. לאחר ההקדמות החגיגיות ניגש לעניין עצמו. היהודי הזה רוצה להשתתך איתך, כפי שידוע לך, יש לו בת, בת ישראל כשרה שהגיעה לפרקה. והוא מחפש עבורה, התלמיד חוכם, השני ישיב ובוחר, בנך, העילוי, הגאון, שרגא חצקל נרו יאיר, יכניס אור למשפחה, וחום, ובנים בעזרת השם.
שם גם מה קורה פה.
והאיש הזה, ינקל שפשוביץ, ידאג למלא את כל חסרונותיו.
כל חסרונותיו. ואם תרצה, אפשר גם לגוון. להושיף. יש עסיסיות, יש מתוקות, יש חריפות, הן באות בכל הטעמים, הגדלים והצורות והכל על חשבון הבית!
איזה שייקס! זה הומור יהודי משובח, תשתלט על עצמך, ינקל, מה אתה עושה?
מה קורה פה? לאן הם את הכל?
בוא חצת שלי, בוא תבדוק את הסחורה לעומד, שלא תגיד שאני מוכר לך פה חתול בשק. אוי, הנה, זאת הבת שלי. רבקלה, בת ישראל, זונה כשרה.
So I saw that production twice, and it was shattering. I watched it with goosebumps. It's a totally brilliant production, and I so wish it could tour and be seen abroad, because it everything about it was just sensational. And as you can see, that sort of unsparing, unflinching lens, a laser focus on religious hypocrisy was one of the things that really made Asch deeply controversial in those early years. So as I said, I'm really grateful, Shane, that the Congress could partner with Asch Wednesday this year, and thank you so much for doing that. And I really want people to know just a bit about what the Congress is and what it does and how they can support it.
With pleasure. The Congress for Jewish Culture is a Yiddishistische Organisation. We're a Yiddishist organization based in New York. We were the World Congress for Jewish Culture, but we have one office now in New York, and we're dedicated to promoting Yiddish language and culture in all of its forms, literary, theatrical, musical, educational, and we're really happy to be partnering with you here on Asch Wednesday this year. If people like to support the Congress, they're welcome to do so. You can check out our website, and I'll put a link for that in the Facebook page here in just one moment. And if you have questions about the Congress, or you'd like advice on learning Yiddish or getting things translated from Yiddish or into Yiddish, don't be afraid to get in touch with us. I'll put both our email and our website in the Facebook chat here.
Right. And it's congressforjewishculture.org, right?
That's right.
Yeah, Congress with a C, although in Yiddish with a K. All right, wonderful. Please do, you know, if you enjoy the program, do support the Congress. They do great work. Time for quiz question number two. Again, three possible choices for this one. Biographies of Sholem Asch online get a lot right, but they get some things wrong. And some of them mention that he was nominated for the Nobel Prize for Literature, and you see various dates for that, or some don't mention it at all. So what is the truth of that? Is it that he wasn't nominated at all for the Nobel Prize for Literature? Is it that he was nominated once in the 1930s after writing his trilogy, Three Cities? Or is it that he was nominated twice in the 1940s? So zero nominations, once or twice. Those are the three choices. We'll find the answer out in due course. All right, so let's move on. And we'll move on to some family history, but I want to just sort of set the scene for those of you that don't really know this. So Asch really kind of steamrolled through multiple controversies in his life, some of his own making. I mean, all in a sense of his own making. He took outspoken positions on a lot of things. But the sort of big one of them all was the one that really sort of dogged him and shadowed him for the last 15, 17 years of his life. And that was prompted by a trilogy of books he wrote, his so-called Christological trilogy. In English, they're the Nazarene, the Apostle, and Mary. And they appeared over a 10-year period from 1939 to 49. And his purpose was very simple, really, to show that Christianity and Judaism were two branches of one tree, in essence. But that led to a campaign against him, and the lie really that he had converted to Christianity and become a kind of missionary, a traitor to the Jewish people. At its height, it resulted in this poisonous book, The Christianity of Sholem Asch, really scurrilous book. And anyway, so that's the background to our next story, which is a little known episode. I'd never heard it until recently, from the end of Asch's life. And so I want you to share it now. So we'll delve into the Sholem Asch family album.
So here's one photo I've always been curious about. It shows Sholem Asch at the bar mitzvah of his grandson, Michael, Mo Asch's son. Here they are, the three of them side by side. And the thing that's always struck me about this picture is Sholem's expression, that kind of weary, defeated look that he has. So then it struck me, why don't I just ask my cousin Michael? So a few days ago, I headed out into the snow to the local Wi-Fi hotspot, and I got Michael on Zoom from his home in Vancouver. So what is the story behind this image?
Well, it must have been 1956 because I was 13 and it was my bar mitzvah. And that picture was taken at a hotel where there was an after bar mitzvah party with all of my schoolmates and so on. Yeah.
So it was the year before Sholem died, in fact, which is, he's in his 70s at this point. And obviously the thing that... 76, right. And the thing that's always struck me is the expression on his face. So what was going on that day?
Well, it was a day, of course, it was my bar mitzvah day. And because my birthday is in April, it was therefore a very important day at the synagogue. And so there was going to be full attendance. For reasons that I don't understand, my mother and a lot of her friends decided that we would all get bar mitzvahed, even though we were very secular. I'd never been to a synagogue before, well, it was before the lessons. And on top of it, they decided on an Orthodox synagogue of the most fundamentalist kind, at least at that time. And for those of you who live in New York, it was Derech Emuno, and it was on Charles Street. And so after taking lessons that day, my family and I went to the synagogue, and of course I was going to say my today I'm a fountain pen speech. And For reasons, again, I don't understand, my grandfather decided to come from England to be there to witness this, which meant he had to take an ocean liner. And I think he took the Queen Mary, which was his favorite ship, as far as I know, and came over. And when we got to the front door, he was there already, and he was in an argument with the men, I mean, massive men, maybe 20, 30 men standing in front of the synagogue entrance. And as I found out soon after, they were arguing that he had no right, that is my grandfather, no right to go into the synagogue because he was no longer a Jew and he had converted to Christianity and he was just going in there to try to convert them. And he argued with them, apparently, using Talmudic law, and I don't know whether it was in Hebrew or in Yiddish, but he argued with them that synagogues are open to everybody and that they couldn't refuse anyone entry, including him, and they relented and let him in. So we went in, and it was one of those synagogues where the men were downstairs and the women upstairs, you know, the whole thing. And I sat on the side with my father, and I got called up and I did my reading, which was very short. As I say, they were kind of scared that I might screw it up. And this was a pretty big holiday. And I sat down, and then afterwards, Sholem decided that, I guess is his tradition, but I don't know enough to say for sure, to come up and say a few words, maybe do a reading, I'm not sure what. And again, this mass of men stood up in front of the Bima and said, no, you can't come up and say anything because you're not a Jew. And he said in response, well, I'm going to say a prayer for my sick wife and you cannot stop anyone from saying a prayer for someone who's sick. Again, using what he knew of Talmudic law, I guess. And they relented and he said a prayer. And then we left, and maybe an hour or two later, we showed up at the hotel, and that's where the picture was taken. Now, I didn't tell your family about this, your grandmother, for a really long time. I don't know why. It didn't really happened to be in a conversation, and I didn't mark it as exceptional, except from my point of view, it just showed me how awful religious Jews can be, and probably, well, not probably, reinforce my sense that I would have nothing to do with that aspect of Judaism ever again. But I eventually told Ruth about this, and she said, "Oh, thank you for telling me. I never had any idea. He came back from England brokenhearted, and I did not know why. And he soon got sick and died about a year later." So that's the story.
Wow, that is some story. So apart from anything else, it must have completely, in a sense, ruined what was such a big day for you.
Yes, it did. And for a while I was kind of resentful of that, and being overshadowed by an event like that. And but on the other hand, as I say, it was a really important lesson for me, which I've carried with me ever since. I don't think I've set foot in a shul except to go purchase something, but I don't think I have ever set foot since then. And I think that might be too strong a reaction, but it is the reaction that I had. It was so cruel, honestly, David. It was so cruel.
So, Cousin Michael, thank you so much. Michael is a professor of anthropology in Canada, and I've never heard that story from him. And listening to it now, I realize, of course, that Sholem never told my grandmother, his daughter, because she clearly didn't know until Michael told her. So it's a pretty powerful story. What do you, either of you, make of it?
That's a tough one. There were so many bilbulim about Asch, most of them don't lead to any effect. Like, I've heard various people say, "Oh, Sholem Asch, Nishki Kent ken Yiddish. He didn't actually know Yiddish. He dictated in German. His secretary translated it into Yiddish." And there are all these, you know, various and sundry things like this. But, you know, to take something out like that on someone, and the way he answered with such equanimity is remarkable. I can see a lot of outrage in the Facebook comments, for instance.
But, and, you know, of course, he had been steeped in religious texts and been intended to be a rabbi by his father. I mean, that was the hope. He knew everything, you know, backwards, and was the most intensely Jewish person I can imagine throughout his life. Certainly a believer, certainly a man of faith. So to hear that is so extraordinary, really. I think it's important to have that known. So I'm really grateful to Michael for sharing it with us.
Yeah, actually, there's a question in the comments. Did Asch convert? And I mean, it shows the effectiveness of that campaign.
Yeah, I've heard that from so many people, especially in America. It really took root, and that lie, I mean, lies, you know, can take root, as we know. And that one really did take root, and many people believed it, and it was absolutely untrue. All right, we should move on. And appropriately, let's go back to Asch's early years, his birthplace, back to Poland, back to Kutna, the shtetl where he was born, and which now has, and has had since 1999, a Sholem Asch festival, a really such an admirable event and such a wonderful event that I go to. It takes place every 2 years. The next one is October this year. And so my friends in Kutna, thank you guys, put together a film to really show you something of the flavor of the Sholem Asch Festival in Kutna.
Kutno remembers about Sholem Asch and our common Polish Jewish history.
Very nice. Some of my friends have been asking, you know, what's the future of Jewish festivals in Poland at this point? But mit werden verkrochen if we begin to head off in that direction. I hope that there will be a peaceful resolution and the uplift of Jewish culture can continue there. Coming up now, we have a guest from Florida, Avi Hoffman. He runs Yiddishkeit, Why I Love Jewish down there. He's a very fine actor. I've had the pleasure of working with him a number of times. And most recently, in fact, it's not even been viewed yet, we have coming up this Sunday, a new dramatization of Itzik Mangel's Megillelieder, which we're calling Megillah Cycle in English. It's not the musical. This is a dramatization directed and adapted by Mike Burstyn and produced by the Congress for Jewish Culture. And Avi was chosen to play the role of, you have your groggers ready, Human Arusha. Okay. And he does a fine job, but Avi has, in fact, I'm going to put a link for the information on that into the comments here, so you can follow and get an alert for it if you like. I just put a link to that in. But if you get the chance, Avi has a very fine one-man show about the great Yiddish poet, maybe the most beloved folk poet in Yiddish culture, Itzik Manger, the one who wrote Auf dem Weg steht der Bäum, which if you know a Yiddish song, you might know that one. Manger was of course the author of Megillelieder, which we're putting up. But here we have a very special letter. David, you dug this up, you found this from Manger to Sholem Asch, and I'm not going to go into the content, but once again, Avi is assuming the persona of Itzik Manger, and he's going to read this remarkable letter from Manger to Sholem Asch about about life. Okay, let's roll it.
Itzik Manger, Two Station Arcade, Swiss Cottage, London, Northwest 6. To Sholem Asch, 121 North Hibiscus Drive, Miami Beach, Florida, Miami, USA. 11th March, 1950, my dear master. I remember our short meeting in London and remember your proposal that you are ready to edit a selection of my poems on your account, because as you told me, that is that. And I understood that you mean real poetry. Now, I don't want your personal money for the publishing of a book of mine, but next year in May, I am 50 years old. Looking around me, there is an emptiness for which even Edgar Allan Poe would really get mad, not drunk. I am afraid of that emptiness. And because of my fear, I decided to celebrate the 50 years. Shall they come, the great, the heavyweights, the small, the tiny, the beauties and the ugly, the Madonnas and the prostitutes, and tell me, on the 28th of May, you are 50. What have you done in your life, a part of being a parasite? Did you build a house? Did you build a home? Did you build up a business, a butchery, a solicitor's business, a synagogue, a church, a brothel? All essentials of life, but I have not done any of these things with my coming 50 years. I stand barren for myself, for my people, and for the world. Apart from my dreams, these are the hieroglyphs of my poems. So simple they are that everybody understands them, even in that accursed language in which I wrote them. They are so clear that I do not understand myself. My dear master, in starting my letter to you, I feel that I run away from the essentials, but it does not matter. Would you like to take part in that masquerade, in that tomfoolery that next year will be called the Jubilee of Itzik Manger's 50 years? If you like to do it, you are invited for a foxtrot between New York in London, or maybe between New York and Jerusalem, and I am ready to dance with you that foxtrot. Cross my heart. Please inform me as to your attitude to this proposal as soon as possible, to the address on the other side. Yours sincerely, Itzik Manger.
Thank you, Avi, so much. That was just wonderful. And look up Manger if you don't know his work. He's a truly great poet. I don't think Asch ever answered that letter. There's no evidence that he did. And in a sense, you know, how do you answer a letter like that? It's a sort of howl of despair and anguish. And, you know, Manger had lost most of his close family in the Holocaust. Asch had lost brothers and many members of his extended family. And they're both, in the shadow of this trauma. So it's a truly extraordinary letter, I think. All right, thank you, Avi, for bringing that to life for us. All right, let's move on, and we move on to quiz question number 3. and it is this. So Asch had four children. My grandmother was the youngest of the four, and the oldest, her brother Nathan, was quite a well-known novelist in the 1920s and 30s in English, in Paris and then in America. Anyway, he wrote a memoir, a very raw, bitter memoir about his father in Commentary magazine in 1963 when both his parents had died. And Nathan was a teenager when the family moved to America in 1914. And he recalls in this memoir something that made him particularly ashamed of being out in public with his father in those years. So, three choices. What was it that made him so ashamed? Was it his father's fractured English and heavy Yiddish accent? Was it his father reading Yiddish newspapers on the subway? Or was it Sholem's habit of drinking tea through a sugar cube in cafes? So, accent, reading Yiddish newspapers, or drinking tea through a sugar cube. You can decide what you think. All right, so now let us move on. And one of the things that I really wanted to do with this year's Asch Wednesday is to show just some of the ways, the many ways in which Asch's work continues to be a source of inspiration, continues to be reworked and adapted to produce new works of art. And one of the most remarkable reworkings involves, again, God of Vengeance. And it produced a song cantata or a monodrama called The Drowning Shore, created just towards the end of last year. The composer is Alistair White, whose latest work is a fashion opera. Alistair does really sort of fabulously interesting philosophical work involving technology and politics and many ideas. But this small scale piece uses a mix of Scots and Yiddish. Alistair is Scottish. And it's sung by my daughter, Clara Kanter, who of course is Asch's great, great granddaughter. And we'll play an extract from it now.
Rub the paste upon the earth. Du Sefer Teure, ich weiß, du bist der große Gott, du bist doch unser Gott, ich hab gesündigt, meine sind, meine sind. Du mach alles, du schick herab auf mir auf Feuer und verbrenn mich, oder soll wie ich steh. Du erfenäuf die Erd und los mich eingesunken wären, nur mein Kind hit mir ab, ich weiß, bei dir ist als möglich, du tu alles, du bist doch ein großer Gott, als nicht bist du kein Gott nicht, sag ich dir ich, als du bist ne Kummerdick, wie ein Mensch bist du, sag ich dir, als du bist, ne Kummerdick. Wie ein Mensch bist du, it's magic.
The girl reaches out to touch her lover. The glass pane almost ripples.
Thank you, Clara.
Oh, that was gorgeous.
Alistair, it's an astonishing piece. It's about 12 minutes long. You can find it online. It's called The Drowning Shore. It's part of a series called Oracles in Sepia. Yeah, it's wonderful. All right. Have you seen that before, Caraid?
No, I haven't. I mean, I saw bits of it, but I haven't seen that. It was just stunning and moving and gorgeous.
Yeah, it's you know, Alistair's work is really special. So check it out. All right, moving on. I'm going to talk briefly. One of the things that's really lovely to me about our interest in Asch is that new stuff is always coming out. His life was so rich and so full, touched so many different areas, that I keep being sent, you know, a cartoon of him that I'd never seen, or a letter that people unearth in archives. And I've been trying to put together the cartoons that appeared about him in the Yiddish press over the years, and there were many, there were dozens of them. And this is one that surfaced in the last year, and it's a really wonderful cartoon from 1910. So Asch went for the first time to America late in 1909. He knew he had to kind of experience and kind of conquer, in a sense, America. So he went there for the first time, and he stayed about 9 months. And this cartoon is from early 1910, so he's been there a few months. And the title of it is Der Grüne Don Quixote. So the Greenhorn Don Quixote. So Asch is a greenhorn because he's new in the country. And here he is as Don Quixote on his horse with his sidekick. And what's he doing? He's tilting at the windmills of Schund. Now, Schund is the name that was given to a large swathe of Yiddish theater. It basically means trash or rubbish. It pretty much meant anything popular that the critics, you know, felt was not sufficiently elitist or highbrow. And this was a period when there was a lot of anxiety about the fact that Schund was taking over the theater, and Asch had this idea to create a Yiddish arts theater, a sort of elite temple of high culture. And of course, it was a kind of doomed, quixotic enterprise from the beginning. It was never going to succeed, but he has a good crack at sort of destroying the windmill of Schund in the center there. So he has Asch on his horse called Chutzpah with his sidekick, Abe Kahn of the Four Woods, who later became one of his bitterest adversaries. So Kahn is Sancho Panza with his donkey. And the windmills in the background are the windmills of the actors and the theaters who kind of embodied the idea of Schund, you know, sellout theater at this time. And it's one of the most glorious cartoons from a satirical Yiddish paper in America in early in 1910, around this campaign that Asch sort of spearheaded that never really got anywhere because, you know, you can't conquer popular taste, of course, as we know. So just a flavor of some of the many cartoons of Asch that appeared, really beautiful, brilliant, clever, cute cartoons that appeared in the Yiddish press all through the decades, sort of tracking his celebrity. All right, so then I think we're gonna move on, Caraid.
Yes, we have another version of God of Vengeance to show you. This one is from Argentina. It's called El Dogma. It's directed by Daniel Tavelis, and he set it in Buenos Aires at the beginning of the 20th century, and he brings in historical facts like the relationship of Jewish immigrants to the prostitution and mafia business in Buenos Aires at the time, and all of the worker strikes that were going on, the radical nature of the immigrant community, as well as the very real pogroms that they were dealing with as a backlash. And he presented it in a mixture of Spanish and also some scenes in Yiddish. So I'm thrilled to see these next scenes for the first time.
¿Acaso la prueba que le pidió Dios a Abraham al ordenar asesinar a su hijo es una prueba de fe? O el poder ilimitado de Dios para someternos.
Yanka, ich hoffe, ich lieb. Hoffe, ich euch lieb.
Wir werden haben Kinder, ein Engel. Schein Engel. Das Gewalt von einem Engel brennt zendig mit sich gebracht.
Ich will nicht, du sollst dich umkehren, du.
Ich bin nicht gekommen, nicht. Ich bin gewesen ein politischer Gefangener.
Du hast gehabt!
Menschen von dem Zar.
Du sabe que la Argentina tierra de libertad. Y ja, und das. Pero, a la ley hay que ayudarla, ¿no? Extranjeros fracasados. ¿Por qué no volverán a sus países, digo? Estamos teniendo problemas en la fábrica de los Krieger-Basel. Se creó una federación obrera. No quieren trabajar, quieren trabajar. Eso es una obscenidad.
Esta es una casa de la alta sociedad.
Van a salir a cazar obreros y judíos. Tenga cuidado.
Eso acá no pasa esas cosas, che. Estamos en Argentina. Acá no pasa eso.
Yo sé lo que usted hace.
¡Soltame! ¡No me pegas más! ¡Escuchaste! ¡No me pegas más!
¿O acaso las putas no tenemos sentimientos? ¿Eh? Nosotras no seremos como las chicas de buena familia, las chicas bien, no tendrán un trabajo como este. Pero, señoritas, cuando una de las nuestras se casa, le es más fiel al marido que cualquiera de ellas, ¿o no?
Que yo y Ángel Chapchovich se salvara del pantano en el que me estoy hundiendo. A ver, vos si sos Dios, hace un día, mandame un fuego y quemame acá mismo.
Gracias. So that's a little taste of Buenos Aires for you, where the play might have had some special resonance. I'm not sure. I think so. Your next chance to see God of Vengeance, the ganze Megillah, the whole play, is coming up in the not too distant future, thanks to the Yiddish Theater Ensemble out in California. I'm going to put a link to their page here in the comments on Facebook, but you can also look them up, Yiddish Theater, that's with a T-R-E, Yiddish Theater Ensemble in California. And they're going to be doing Caraid's translation of God of Vengeance. I think that's Caraid's first major translation. It was my first real encounter with the play many years ago. And that production requires a separate event at some point, I think. It was really interesting. But Caraid, you didn't just hit and quit Sholem Asch. Do you care to tell us about other projects you've got ongoing?
Yes, I've been working with the Yiddish Book Center for the past 2 years as a translation fellow to translate four plays of Sholem Asch that have never before been in English. They include his first drama, On the Road to Zion, about a patriarch who decides he's going to leave Poland and go to Israel. The second one, Our Faith, about a interfaith marriage between a Jewish girl and a Polish farmer. A String of Pearls, which is a play about the horrors of World War I. And then finally, The Dead Man, which is a play about the aftermath of World War I. And these plays were all written between 1905 and just after World War I. But I'm really excited to introduce to you this short 6-minute film that I did of a scene from On the Road to Zion. And it is very much an answer to those misguided synagogue viewers or attendees of that bar mitzvah of Sholem Asch all those years ago at his grandson's bar mitzvah. And when I think of what he has, so a man who has created so much genius work, to have not only dealt with these artistic injuries of the suppression of his work, but also the spiritual injuries, which happen, of course, across religions, it gives me special honor and privilege to introduce his words in English from this play, his first play at 25 years of age that he wrote in 1905, featuring Hal Robinson.
Stay. Enough with accompanying me. Time has come to say goodbye. I'm leaving you here at the outpost. After I speak with you, after we say goodbye, as soon as I go beyond this crossing, I become part of your past. This is the last time I'll ever see you. The earth where I was born will not hide me beneath it. I was always a stranger in this land. I'm going off to a land that is very far from here, yet very close to me. I am abandoning you here in a land that is very close to us, but very far from me. All these years, we planted our roots in the wind, yet no wind could pull us out from our roots. Do you know why? We, all Jews, have a great, great foundation. That is our faith. Our faith in our Father, who sent us here, and who, when the time has come, will also take us away from here. The fiercest winds from the stormiest days could not stir us from our place. We have wandered from land to land. We've mastered language after language. But our essential being remained our own. In the place of our own land, of our own country, was our faith. But you, who have transformed our great God into tiny little gods, have you found a foundation that can protect you during the days when the storm winds blow and the wild oceans surpass their sandy shores and flood the world? Do you understand what I've just said? Can you promise me that the earth won't throw out your old father from his grave because the living people he has left behind have disgraced and dishonored him? I don't want to criticize you or quote scripture about the dangers of straying from the Jewish path. Today's world demands different ways of being. But are you certain of your faith in these new doctrines? Have you studied these other ways of living?
The Messiah is coming. The Messiah is coming. The Messiah is coming. The Messiah is coming. The Messiah is coming.
Enough, my children. Enough, my grandchildren. The time's come to say goodbye. It feels like the right moment, the right minute. Pay attention to my departure. You've expressed yourselves to me in the name of many gods, many messiahs. Each one of you has a different idea of what it means to be a Jew, with your own separate Torah, each one and your Messiah. But always remember, I am the trunk from which your branches grow. All of us, the whole tree, with your branches, with your roots, that is the eternal Jew. The Jew who was, is, and always will be. That tree is now divided. Each branch has taken her piece of the root and left, gone away to plant herself. God, send your one and only Messiah to give us all one unifying soul. I feel that the right time is coming close. Let him come and dissolve borders between country after country, between people after people. The right time has come, the time of the Messiah. You hear it calling us? Listen. They're calling to us. The time is now.
The time is now. The time is now. Time.
You did. So you said to me you were going to record a monologue from the play, and you had a neighbor who was an actor in your building. So I was expecting this sort of corridor shot outside your door, you know, this guy appearing in a corridor somewhere, and this is what you delivered. It's just extraordinary. And I didn't know anything about Hal. I'm ashamed to say I hadn't heard of Hal's work. So just tell us something about him, maybe.
Well, Hal's an amazing actor. He's been on Broadway and Grand Hotel and The Price and Cabaret, but he started off his career as a singer, and he was in operas, and he sang in choirs for both synagogues and churches. That's how he made money as a young actor. And he has a real sense of the connection between the theater of religion and the theater of theater. And I think Sholem Asch loves to explore that in his work. But one reason that I knew that Hal and Sholem Asch character would be so perfect for one another is that, like Sholem Asch, Hal has a really strong social and moral conscience. For instance, he founded the community garden where we all chat and get together every, you know, when the weather's fine, but he took 8 years off of acting in his 30s to found a homeless shelter for families in San Francisco, which he ran for 8 years and then returned to doing his Broadway work. So that, you know, that's the thing. If you have an actor who is as good as the text, it's something magical always happens.
And that was magical. Thank you, really. That was, and made me want to see your full translation on stage as soon as possible, hopefully.
I hope so.
Yeah, and all the others that you've been working on. All right, somebody asked apparently whether, in reference to the Buenos Aires production, whether Sholem Asch ever engaged directly with what was called the Svi Migdal, this organization, this powerful organization of pimps and sort of organized white slave traders. So as far as I know, the answer is no. You know, there were many plays about prostitution and specifically Jewish prostitution, many kind of crusading plays, many social conscience plays, but Asch never wrote that sort of play. He never wrote a sort of directly topical or political play of that sort, and certainly not as far as I know about the Buenos Aires organization, which ran a lot of the prostitution business until around 1930 or so. All right, so we're coming towards the end. Quiz question number four, lastly, this is my favorite one. Some of you may have heard this in previous Asch Wednesdays. Anyway, it goes like this. For a few months in 1917, Asch and Leon Trotsky moved in the same circles. They were both in New York. Both were published by the New York Yiddish paper, The Forwards. But of course, Trotsky goes back in the middle of the two revolutions in 1917. He leaves the US in March, and he left owing Sholem Asch $200. And the question is, a debt he never repaid, by the way. And the question is, why? What was this debt about? So three possibilities. First is, Asch had lent him money, which unbeknownst to him, Trotsky had used to buy weapons on the black market. The second is that Asch had stood guarantee for Trotsky's furniture bill when he was doing up his rooms in New York. And the third is that Asch had invested in a radical Russian language journal which Trotsky was editing. So black market weapons, furniture, or a radical journal. All right. And now let us go back to Batyam, to the house. And one of the things they've done beautifully in recent years is to have a program of artists in residence. And a pair of artists, Caroline Maxwell and Tal Yisrael, who run a project called the Department of Nocturnal Affairs, the DNA, wonderful title. They were in residence from California and Israel, taking their inspiration from artwork and other objects in the house, like the portrait we saw earlier by the artist Maritzi Gottlieb. So let's see some of the work that they produced.
So I decided from this painting that I would actually respond in paintings. I saw that this painting was a sort of, you know, traditional portrait sort of painting, and this idea of something with their eyes closed. I thought, how would the Department of Nocturnal Affairs respond to this question, this idea? So I decided to create a series of companions for her that I could send, because I know that I could send artwork there to the house. Since I couldn't travel myself, I could at least send paintings through the mail. So I did a series of portraits of animals, nocturnal animals, with their eyes closed to join her on whatever journey in darkness she's on. So we have a badger here, which is a nocturnal animal with his eyes closed. And we have a few other ones here. There's a coyote, which here in Los Angeles, these are some of the most common nocturnal animals, a lot like a jackal. Another one, an owl with its eyes closed. And then finally, I think I did a last one of rats with their eyes closed, just any sort of nocturnal animal. And the idea also is that, you know, they're nocturnal. They're used to being in the dark. They're used to seeing in the dark. So why would they close their eyes even again, in darkness? If they're living in the night, there's something else about closing your eyes. It's a different sort of darkness than just nocturnal darkness that is useful, that's interesting, and that's where we wanted to go with this.
And then the painting is arrived in a box, and I had those precious paintings, and they were very much related to the house, but they kind of searched for a location where to hide from light. And luckily, Asch had so many hidden dark places in the house, like the drawers and other cabinets. And they're beautifully just found themselves here in his writing desk drawer. And they stayed there throughout the duration of the residency. And every time I worked there, they just picked from the drawing. I felt that they were there for me. The next one is actually looking from the inside. I felt that at the beginning I was looking at the house, but at some point I was identifying with the house itself. I felt already welcome to interfere, and as if those furnitures were standing them for a long time and have their stories about the house. So I started to look from the furnitures outside. And this is one of the experiments with Caroline's paintings. I put them in the drawer, and I put my camera in the drawer as well. And the light is coming through this crack and through the keyhole to shine on it. And I felt that this moment was kind of encapsulating a moment of darkness and light at the same place. And another point of view that I tried is looking from the books, because he's writing, and the works of artists that he met with, they were all inspired from books, from history. And his books is a beautiful collection. They're not only beautiful in writing, but also in their the way they look like, and the years did a lot of justice to them. So here I was looking at the room from the point of view of knowledge of stories, and I tried several points of view on the house like that. Another way of looking at the house that was much later was the places that allowed thinking and wondering and daydreaming. And there's so many comfortable armchairs in the house, as if in every corner of the house it's possible to sit and just wonder and imagine. So I was sitting with the camera. I just let the camera sit in the armchairs and just wander at the room. And I sent those photographs to Caroline after I felt all the fabrics and the little carving on the woods, and she responded with those paintings that actually describe even better this moment of daydreaming or thinking or collecting ideas.
Yeah, with these ones, instead of making paintings that were really dark and more about nighttime or darkness, I thought it was interesting to take the idea of dreaming and daydreaming this time. You know, it's not a nocturnal dreaming, it's a daydreaming. But to sort of, you know, to fill this with painting, the sort of levity and sort of like floatingness perhaps of what happens to your own sense of being and, you know, physicality, but, you know, as daydreaming. And so again, this is just from these photographs that Tal took of the point of view of the chairs, and, you know, to feel like we're sitting in this chair, and yet, you know, where the self sort of dissolves into the room, and really trying to paint these with more of a sense of light versus the nocturnal darkness, but yet to, you know, have the same sense of mystery and wonder that, you know, that we would get during nocturnal moments of darkness and dreaming as well.
So that's the Department of Nocturnal Affairs. You can see their work at dnaoffice.org, carolynmaxwell.net, and talyisrael.com. And really, I thought, stunning, beautiful, beautiful work. All right, Shane, remind us how people can support the Congress for Jewish Culture, which is hosting this event. You're muted, Shane.
Sure. First off, the Congress is a 501c3, so your donations are tax deductible to the extent allowable by law. And you can either send an old-fashioned check, and you'll find the address on our website at www.congressforjewishculture.org, which I'm putting into the chat yet again. And if you like to be mildly more modern, you can send via paypal.me/Congress, K-O-N-G-R-E-S. That's in Yiddish transliteration. Okay. And we'll hope that you can help us with future programs like this.
Please, please, please do, if you possibly can, support the Congress. All right, so final item coming up, and before we get to it, competition time. So the answers to our quiz, they are here. All right.
I just want to say the final item, really, you have to stick around for. It's all been building to this to a degree.
This is so true. All right, so quickly through the four questions. Asch and Gorky, what language or languages would they have used together? The answer to that is that anything that you said might be right. There is a description of Asch in Russia in 1928 that said he spoke in Russian, but it had a rather tangential relation to the Russian language. In reality, he spoke a mixture of Russian, Polish, and Yiddish, inserting words from English and French. It was Asch's Esperanto. So my sense is they probably spoke in Russian, but you know, it could have been any of those three. Question two, the Nobel Prize. Answer three, he was nominated twice in the 1940s, both times by a professor of German and Scandinavian literature who was a member of the Nobel Academy. Question three, why was his son Nathan so ashamed of being out in public with his father? It was answer two, his father reading Yiddish newspapers on the subway. And finally, Anton Trotsky. So weapons on the black market or furniture or the radical journal, what did you have?
Furniture.
Furniture is the right answer. Furniture is the right answer, yes. All right, so now we really do have briefly a competition. We have, thanks to the kind folk at Yale at the Beinecke Library, five copies. They found some unsold stock of this book, which is now impossible to get hold of. So we have five copies to give away, and there are two ways you can win one. All right, one is to caption this photograph that we saw earlier. Matt, if you can bring up this photograph of Sholem Asch with a pigeon on his head. That was in Venice in 1923. And so caption this photograph. You can caption it as the pigeon, as Sholem Asch, as his wife, or as anything you like, really. That is one way to win a book. Caption this photo, Asch with the pigeon on his head. And the second way is for you Yiddishists out there, which is this question concerning Sholem Asch and Isaac Bashevis Singer. The two writers share what I will call a watery bond or link. What is that? What is that watery connection or bond? All right, so those are the two ways you can win one of these books. You can message me on Facebook. You can email me dmazower, D-M-A-Z-O-W-E-R, @gmail.com. All right, so now, this is gonna be fun. So we thought we would end with a world premiere, actually the second world premiere, because Caraid's monologue was a world premiere. But we're going to return to Asch's breakthrough play, God of Vengeance. And let us remind ourselves of what happens in Act Two when the teenage daughter elopes with the prostitute. And here is part of that scene from the production that Shane alluded to earlier, 1999, in Show World, a former strip club in Times Square, Caraid and her husband's production of God of Vengeance, Act Two.
Wait, your parents have gone to sleep, and they will soon call and meet at the table. We are shy, so be shy. Then we go slowly towards one another. I am Nahosin. And you? You are my Kala. Take you in my arms. I hold you tightly. We kiss each other. Very softly, we kiss each other. It is good with her. Good. Yeah, Marka. Yeah.
So that was the sort of mock wedding scene from Act Two. And now we come to the world premiere part, and it concerns this. A year later, that play was so controversial, so much discussed, that a rival writer of Asch's, David Frischmann, another famous Warsaw writer, wrote a parody of it called God of Mercy. And in this parody, there are the parents, Yankel and Sora, and they have a kid, but it's not a daughter, it's a wayward son, a teenager. And it's a boy who spends all his time with his male friends studying holy texts. And he shows no signs of becoming what his parents want him to be, which is a regular businessman with a girlfriend. So time for some creative thinking. Let's catch up with the parents in Act One as they berate their son for not being a normal boy.
What are you stumbling around for, all bent and hunchback and useless? Such a misfortune. When your father sees you, he'll have a fit. He'll give you such a beating. Just think of all that daddy has done to steer you down the right path. Right now, he's bringing a nanny home for you. A beautiful, young, alluring maiden. And with God's help, she'll be a good luck charm. She'll teach you what life is really about. How to be the man your father wants. Having a nanny, dear son, is like, pardon the comparison, but it's like having a Torah scroll in the house. Soon all the other rich kids will flock to you because of her, and they'll all be your friends. Oh, my dear boy. Oh, shh. Daddy's coming. For God's sake, don't look so pale. Act like you got some life in you.
Son, throw away that prayer book and get rid of that yarmulke. Come over here. Come over here. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Look, Daddy loves you very much. He's getting you a present. Blut und Milch, blood and milk. Cost me a lot of money. She'll be waiting for you in your room. She'll have her own bed next to yours. She'll make a man out of you. Slowly, but surely, she'll get that idleness out of your system. Look, son, a young woman in your room is like, lahavdil, you should excuse the comparison, but it's like a Torah scroll in a play. Her shirt is like the curtain over a Torah ark. Her body is like the sacred parchment. Her head is like the Torah crown. Son, are you listening to me? What's wrong with you?
He's not listening to them. Instead, he's dreaming of running away, and he goes to the study house to his friends to join his male student friends poring over religious books. So let's meet them, Ruvindel, the son played by Miriam Chaya Siegel, and first, his best friend, Menachem, played by Michal Yashinsky.
If Ruvindel would come soon, we could run away from here. His father's money would be enough for all of us.
Quiet. Speak softly. Everyone's asleep at my house, so I stole away and came over here. Where's Menachem? I was drawn to him. I'm afraid my father will find out and beat me. If my father catches me here in the study house, he'll lay me out dead in the earth.
Come, Ruvindel. It's so warm over here. The air smells so good, like old books. Come.
Sha. I'm afraid. My father hid the key under the nanny's pillow so that I would have to come to her. I got out of bed to come here. I was nearly naked. I went over to where she was on the little bed. She was lying there half uncovered. We must remain covered up. As I reached under her head to get the key, I nearly touched the devil's hand. And what kind of a schwarzjur would I have anything to do with such a girl? I'm drawn to you. Boy, this is the stuff that tragedies are made of.
Oh, Ruvindel, you are cold. Calm yourself. You're with me now. Let's lie down here on the floor. Come. Like this, our backs hunched over from too much studying get more hunched. Our forehead wrinkles grow deeper. Our necks bend further. Oh, isn't this good? Just like blades of grass waving in the meadow in a Yiddish drama. Come. Rest your nose in the extreme hunch of my back. Look, I'm embracing you with my payas, with my curly payas. It's so cool, just as if water were flowing between us. Just like in a drama. I want to hold you like you're my bride. Do you want that?
Yes, yes.
We will sleep in one bed. Every night will be like Erev Shabbos. Your father will never come near us. We'll go far, far away from him. Oh, will you run far, far away with me? Come, come, let's elope. We'll run away to a distant yeshiva.
Such fun. So there you go, a flavor of the kind of parody, the biting parody of Asch's masterpiece that would have no doubt, you know, had Warsaw laughing in 1908. Appeared in a theater journal, never before performed. So there you go. So that's it. That concludes the formal part of our program. We will stay up a bit longer on Facebook. So if you can and you want to, stay with us. But let me just say a huge thanks, first of all, to you all for watching. To Shane and Caraid, thank you so much for supporting this with me. And thanks to Matt Temkin, our tech wizard behind the scenes. Matt, brilliant, thank you so much. To the Congress of Culture and to everyone who worked so hard to make this program happen. Let's see them.
Yeah, thank you, David. David really put this together and he sewed it together quite beautifully, I think. And now when travel is back, you all know where you can go to see Sholem Asch over the world.